Buongiorno a tutti. La maratona è quasi finita, siamo a 100 metri, forse 150. Una giornata lunga domani. Oggi abbiamo 5 ospiti, speriamo 5 ospiti più o meno brevi nei loro interventi per lasciare tempo per le domande. C'è il Cardinale Schönborn di Vienna e Sua Eccellenza Monsignor Raymond Martin di Armagh in Irlanda. E Sua Eccellenza Anthony Muheria di Kenya e poi il padre Kike Figueredo che viene della Cambogia e il giovane uditore Erdwin Ortega che viene di Cuba, membro della comunità di Sant'Egidio. Però cominciamo come sempre con Paolo Ruffini.
Solo per ricordarvi alcune cose sull'appunto questa fase finale del sinodo, che domattina verrà letto in aula il documento finale, che sarà votato punto per punto, che servirà la maggioranza qualificata dei 2/3 dei presenti per approvare ogni singolo paragrafo. Per dirvi per quanto riguarda noi che domani non faremo il briefing alle 13:30, ma diciamo verrò alla fine della giornata, quindi quando sarà poi stato votato il documento, per informarvi sull'esito. E che oggi pomeriggio invece ci sarà un incontro tra i padri sinodali e i giovani partecipanti al sinodo, che per ringraziare anche del sinodo faranno un incontro anche con momenti di, diciamo così, spettacolo, ma insomma si tratta di leggere delle poesie che rappresentino le loro culture, momenti di danza, di poesia, di canto, e sarà oggi pomeriggio e che poi diciamo sarete diciamo diffonderemo tramite il sistema dei media, Vatican Media, delle immagini su questo. Poi che più tardi avrete anche dalla sala stampa alcuni dati, cioè quanti padri sinodali sono intervenuti, insomma, anche sul traffico sui social, su cosa hanno fatto i media vaticani. Comunque vi do quello più importante, che sono intervenuti in totale 240 padri sinodali nelle congregazioni che hanno discusso le tre parti di Instrumentum Laboris e 32 uditori, e negli interventi liberi 69 padri sinodali e 13 uditori.
Bene. Grazie Paolo. Cominciamo con il giovane Erdwin Ortega.
Sí, gracias. Quisiera sobre todo agradecer a todos los que están aquí presentes al sínodo y a esta compartir un poco la experiencia que he tenido y que hemos tenido como jóvenes en el sínodo de los obispos por los jóvenes. Y quisiera sobre todo decir que ha sido una experiencia realmente rica, digamos, de sobre todo de escucha y de aprender otras culturas, porque el sínodo está representado por muchos jóvenes que representan varias culturas, varias lenguas, tienen muchas historias y han enriquecido, digamos, han compartido sus testimonios en la que ha ayudado mucho a este documento final en la que vamos, digamos, se hará. Quisiera decir que una de las cosas que nosotros como jóvenes nos sentimos agradecidos, sobre todo al Papa Francisco, es que nos ha invitado a este sínodo y que hemos tenido la oportunidad de ser escuchados y de escuchar. Es la primera cosa que quisiera decir. La segunda cosa es que los padres sinodales han tenido la oportunidad de escucharnos directamente, de entender nuestras dudas, también nuestros sufrimientos, nuestras situaciones que se viven en diferentes partes del mundo, y han querido recoger esto también en los documentos que de cierta manera lo veremos al final. Podemos entender que al final ese documento va a tener un carácter sinodal, un carácter de comunión, de compartir, digamos, experiencias juntos, donde hemos escuchado, digamos, hemos respondido también a preguntas que muchos jóvenes que viven en nuestros países, pero también en nuestras comunidades han tenido y tienen, y la Iglesia quiere hacer, dar una respuesta, sobre todo, no a aquellos jóvenes solamente que ya están en la Iglesia, sino a todos los jóvenes. Una Iglesia que quiere caminar junto con los jóvenes, no para los jóvenes, sino con los jóvenes. Gracias.
Gracias.
Archbishop Martin.
Good afternoon, everyone. I feel that I've been part of a graced moment over the past month. I have to say, coming out here to Rome, I was coming out with a certain amount of skepticism, because in many ways at home in Ireland, we've been trying to connect with young people and haven't really made a very good job of it. We have great connections with young people in their families and indeed through our Catholic school system. But one of our big regrets is, how do we reach young people after that? Or indeed, how do we engage with young people and understand their world and try to involve them in being church? But having come here and having experienced the whole program of the Synod, that whole movement of reflection from seeing and recognizing the concrete realities of the lives of young people to trying to interpret those realities in light of our faith and our understanding of the meaning of vocation and discernment and accompaniment, and then really trying to think about where do we go from here. I have felt really that it has been a graced moment over this past few weeks. I also came out here with a little bit of regret that the Holy Spirit seemed to have been left out of the working document. And I mentioned that in the Synod Hall, and quite a number of the Synod Fathers agreed. But I have felt the presence of the Holy Spirit during the Synod in the communion that has been generated there, the communion of the bishops collegially meeting together with the Holy Father, with Peter and under Peter, the communion between bishops, pastors, theologians, and especially the communion that has been generated by the presence of the young people in the aula and in the discussion groups. I have felt the presence and the power of the Holy Spirit. Because I think, and I genuinely believe, if we are to rejuvenate our church, if we are to bring our church alive again with the life and the gifts of young people, then it has to be the action of the Holy Spirit. We have to call for that new Pentecost, that new springtime, where we are able to, you know, crack open the power of the Spirit in the church. So having experienced this graced moment and having experienced the power of the Holy Spirit, I'm now a bit nervous, because I know I have to go home and try to bring some of this power and joy and life that we experienced at the Synod and make it work in the reality of the particular churches in Ireland, my own archdiocese, and also indeed within our conference of bishops. And therefore, I feel I have to be an ambassador for the Synod. I have to bring some of the infectious joy and life that we experienced here and try to spread it and try to put it into action in the life of the church. And in order to do that, I know that I need the help of our young people in Ireland. Somehow, we have to be able to engage with them, encourage them, and to give them the space to become church in their own lives and with their peers and in their own parishes and in the temporal affairs of the life of our country. Because it is our young people who inhabit the world of media, politics, communications. It is our young people who are part of healthcare systems, who are there in our legal systems, in politics, in policing. And somehow we have to encourage them engage with them so that they can become leaven in society, transforming society from within with their gifts and their charisms.
Thank you, Archbishop. Cardinal Schönborn.
Per me non è la prima esperienza di sinodale. Ho contato 6 sinodi, penso, che ai quali ho partecipato. Devo dire che è stato per me il migliore di tutti che ho vissuto. Era un'assemblea gioiosa, abbiamo riso molto, c'era un eccellente ambiente, serio, ascolto e vera comunio. Io devo dire sinceramente che quando ho ricevuto la nomina per il sinodo mi sono detto magari quasi un mese, la diocesi è grande, arcidiocesi di Vienna, cosa fare un mese a Roma? Oggi devo dire che pensare che 270 vescovi di tutto il mondo, di tutte le parti del mondo, prendono un mese di tempo per ascoltare giovani, per condividere con loro sulla loro situazione, ascoltare le loro esperienze. Chiedo se potete darmi un social body, comparable body, sorry, I switched. Potete darmi un paragonabile gruppo di leaders che prendono il tempo un mese intero ad ascoltare la situazione dei giovani. Non scientificamente, anche c'è stata molta competenza scientifica in tutto il cammino sinodale, ma anzitutto con empatia, con simpatia, con vera attenzione. Non per avere già tutte le risposte pronte, ma per condividere con loro le domande, i sogni, le visioni, eccetera. Terzo punto, mi chiedo se nell'eco pubblico a questo sinodo, non lo dico per lamentarmi, ma forse abbiamo anche mancato di trasmettere sufficientemente, ma tutto ciò che abbiamo sentito da giovani del mondo di oggi, da vescovi che condividono la situazione dei giovani nei loro paesi, di sofferenze, di terribili ingiustizie dei quali soffrono tanti giovani nel mondo. Non devo elencare queste ingiustizie, ma e mi auguro che, ma forse non l'abbiamo ancora fatto sufficientemente, che ci sia una voce anche forte per dire al mondo politico, economico, quante ingiustizie ci sono nel mondo. Pensiamo solo di ciò che si è parlato molto, della migrazione. Perché i giovani scappano dal loro paese? Perché non vedono un futuro? Tutte questa empatia, questa simpatia per ciò che il mondo dei giovani oggi, situazione di lavoro precarie, senza certezza del futuro. E non parlo solo di paesi dell'Africa, ma anche dell'Europa. E finire con una parola che mi ha detto un giovane africano di un paese dove c'è guerra civile, dove c'è molta ingiustizia, esploitazione dai grandi poteri economici, le risorse ricchissime del paese che vanno tutti fuori. E questo giovane mi ha detto: la Chiesa è nostra unica speranza, perché qui troviamo un luogo di accolto, di comprensione, dove possiamo essere noi, giovani, a casa. E per questo, per me, questo sinodo, già il fatto di questo sinodo è un segno grande. Auspico solo che sia visto, ascoltato e forse anche grazie al vostro lavoro trasmesso. Grazie.
Grazie, Eminenza. E Monsignor Mujeria.
Thank you very much and good afternoon to you all. The synod that we have just lived and are still living in the last hours has been an exceptional experience of universality of the church, of collegiality, of fraternity, and also even of just living together. And we hope that it will be a true chorus, which was a chorus of the old and the young bishops, the old and the young priests, the young people present, the religious, old and young, who all were one voice, inviting the whole world, inviting the whole church, that we can focus on nurturing, molding, giving worthwhile future to our youth. This has been a wonderful experience. There has been moments of exchanges, there's been moments of sharing, there's been moment also largely of listening to one another, listening to the young people listening to us, listening to other bishops from other parts of the world with very diverse experiences, terribly different problems. And at the same time, a moment of self-examination. Each one of the bishops present would somehow measure himself to what he was hearing. And that is the whole work of discernment. From listening, you examine, you assess, and hopefully you start making a program looking forward. At the same time, we have seen and been awakened to the reality of tapping from the resourcefulness of the young people, which is a great asset in the church. This has been a wonderful awakening for us all. But besides the discussions and what will arise from the indications, from the deliberations, and from the document, what perhaps I hope and we hope is that we'll come from this synod with a new flame, a kind of a fire that is able to enthuse the young people, to engage them, to give new life to the church. Something a little more than just word, commitment. And that means for us bishops, I hope that we'll be able to pass on this flame, not only to the Catholic, not only to all the youth, but also to our conferences, to our particular churches, that we need to work with them, we need to care for the young people, we need to listen to them, and hopefully we'll be able to set them on fire with the love of God and for this mission, which Pope Francis has reminded us so much. This means instilling hope. And so to me, perhaps at this moment, I'm looking at what will happen after tomorrow, what will happen after Sunday, giving back hope, giving back belonging, giving back missionary responsibilities to our young people. And somehow we see this as a continuation of a lot of the preparations we had before the synod. And in our country, in Kenya, there was a slogan we used, faith on fire, telling the young people, let's set our faith on fire, let's blow, let the Holy Spirit come, and so that those embers can burst into a flame in the church. A new kind of fire, sense of responsibility. That's my hope that this synod will bring about. It will be both awakening the faith of the young who have listened. We've listened to the hurdles that they've had, the challenges that they've had, and it's up to us now to make them, give them the certainty that they can stand with their faith, for us to accompany them to face these hurdles, helping them, as the Pope has said, also Pope Francis, that their dreams, that they can have great dreams of the church, great dreams for the future of the world, a better world, as Cardinal also has mentioned, but just beyond what is measurable, great dreams of holiness, a topic that has been constantly present in the hall of the Synod. And that means involving us, to engage them, connecting with them to the work of grace as well, something that has come out. It's sometimes we are very, we're prone to think about activities and forget who is the author. The connecting them with Christ, that they can touch God as a way. How do we make them, how do we bring them to touch Jesus? How do we make it easy for Jesus to speak to them? What new ways? And that's the new changes that we have to certainly think. And we hope the Holy Spirit won't stop working after Saturday, and especially with the bishops, that he's going to really blow hard so that we can have new ideas and have new ways of reaching out to the young people, so that it's not just a little meeting we had. It wasn't a meeting. It was more. It is, as a bishop said, my brother Archbishop, is a moment of grace in the Holy Spirit. So we will have to change approaches. And for me, that is what I find now a good adventure, going out as a new church, wanting into adventure with the young people. And so that brings youthfulness to the church. There are moral challenges, without doubt. When I think of Africa, where the large part of the Catholic youth in Africa and Asia, it means that this synod must speak something concrete to them. It must be able to connect with them. And that perhaps is what we'll have to think and pray. Being very religious, being very connected, largely there, they have as well serious moral challenges. But how do we make them now awaken and somehow be able to advance on this path of encounter with Christ? In a word, this synod has been a wonderful listening to an orchestra, perhaps you may say. At the beginning, maybe sometimes you will hear one of the instrument a bit off, maybe. We shouldn't listen too much to that flute that is a bit off. But as you go there, the Holy Spirit guides us to a real great symphony, which I pray will be what we'll hear coming Monday. But I hope this music will be played by all of you, and we too, together, bishops, old men, young men, parents, the youth, are able to play the symphony that now we are bringing, God willing, the Holy Spirit has made arise within the womb of the church. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Archbishop. Padre Quique.
Muchas gracias. Muchas cosas han sido dichas, entonces sobre el sínodo voy a ser más breve. Yo vengo de Camboya, que es un lugar donde la iglesia es pequeña y muy joven, con lo cual el tema de la juventud para nosotros es un tema del día, y los jóvenes son los que nos ayudan a que la iglesia sea una iglesia en salida, una iglesia dinámica, una iglesia que se adapta a las necesidades de las personas. También nuestra iglesia en Camboya es una iglesia que ya físicamente está en los márgenes de la geografía, pero también en los márgenes de los retos que tenemos. Estamos reconstruyendo la iglesia desde las cenizas, estamos reconstruyendo la iglesia desde las heridas que ha dejado la guerra. Estamos respondiendo a necesidades básicas como es la salud, la educación, la búsqueda de trabajo. Y estamos en retos que nos hacen estar muy cerca de la gente, ¿no? Gente joven, gente rota, gente con pocas oportunidades, gente pobre. Entonces, en este contexto, para mí el sínodo ha sido un momento muy bonito en tres aspectos. Primero, de escucha, porque he escuchado a los jóvenes, he escuchado a otros obispos y he escuchado diferentes situaciones en el mundo que me han iluminado y me han reconfortado, me ha dado alegría, ¿no? Tengo aquí, voy a decir, cuatro participaciones que me han llamado mucho la atención y que me han gustado y que me las llevo para Camboya. Una es del cardenal arzobispo de Addis Abeba, de Surafiel, que habló del armamento, del comercio de armas, de la migración de los jóvenes africanos y hacía preguntas, ¿cómo es esto, no? Me pareció profundo y que es una realidad impresionante que tenemos que escuchar, porque también la sufrimos en Camboya durante mucho tiempo. También el arzobispo de Westminster, Nichols, nos habló del trato, de la trata de seres humanos, que es otro tema crucial. Yo cuando he oído estas participaciones, a mí me ha encantado y estoy muy contento de ser parte de este sínodo en donde se debaten estos temas. También el arzobispo de Venezuela, Parra, nos ha hablado del liderazgo en la Iglesia, de acompañar, de saber escuchar, de estar con. También me ha fascinado su manera de entender cómo tenemos que caminar juntos en la Iglesia. Y también María Luisa Berzosa ha hablado de la participación de la mujer, de que desde dentro la mujer puede hacer que la Iglesia esté más cercana a los problemas del mundo y a los problemas de las personas. Entonces, tengo aprendizaje, ¿no? Aprendizaje que me llevo de este sínodo. Tengo que también decir que para mí es un hito en el cual, y es la primera vez que participo en un sínodo, no puedo comparar con otros sínodos, pero lo que escucho es que es un sínodo en el que la participación, el intercambio, la fraternidad es muy clara y eso me confirma a mí en mi ministerio, en la Iglesia. Y también, si tengo que decir, dos frutos que me llevo de este sínodo. Uno es confirmación para mi misión en Camboya, para seguir respondiendo a las necesidades básicas de la gente con los jóvenes y hacer que la Iglesia muestre el rostro misericordioso del Señor, que sea una Iglesia samaritana. Y también me llevo mucha alegría, amistades, encuentros y que hay que seguir trabajando. Gracias.
Gracias, Padre Quique. Adesso la parola a voi. Nome testata, Elisa. Sì.
Marco Mancini, ACI Stampa. Avevo bisogno di due precisazioni, diciamo, procedurali. La prima, se i padri sinodali sono votanti, sono 264, almeno facendo i conti nell'elenco mi risultavano essere 264. E la seconda, se la maggioranza dei due terzi per ogni votazione si calcola in base appunto ai 264 o in base ai presenti in aula al momento del voto? Grazie.
Si calcola sulla base dei presenti al voto. I votanti e gli aventi diritto sarebbero tutti tranne il Papa che non vota, essendo il documento rivolto a lui. E quanti saranno lo sapremo quando ci sarà la votazione.
Salve, buongiorno, io sono Elise Harris, lavoro con Crux. Una domanda per i padri, ovviamente, sinodali. Ci sono i voci dicendo che nel documento finale si usa il frase, parlando dell'omosessualità, si usa il frase orientazione sessuale e nel passato mi pare che hanno usato tendenza sessuale, quindi c'è una differenza su orientazione significa una cosa più naturale dalla natura e tendenza no. Quindi usare questa frase, volevo chiedere se questo significa un sviluppo nella posizione della Chiesa su questo punto o no. Grazie.
Non abbiamo ancora il testo definitivo, non penso nessuno di noi può rispondere alla questione, perché il testo definitivo lo vediamo domani.
Deborah Castellano Lubov of Zenit, the English edition. My question would be for Cardinal Schonburn, Archbishop Martin, and Archbishop Anthony. Just, we've spoken a lot about the listening and the transmission, all the good ideas that have been mentioned during the course of these weeks, but I'm curious what has been your greatest takeaway? Have there been concrete proposals that you will bring back to your archdiocese, something that you would like to implement or that has struck you in a particular way? Thank you.
I'll begin. I think for me, it's really this realization that young people are not only the the objects of our ministry. You know, that I came to the Synod with this sense that, look, I need to learn here about how I can minister better to young people. I'm going home with a far greater sense of young people being agents of evangelization themselves, being missionary disciples, and with the challenge, as I mentioned already, of how can I make that happen? One of my greatest takeaways is that phrase from the Gospels, new wine, fresh skins. You know, where Jesus said, no one tries to put new wine into old wineskins, otherwise the skins will burst and the wine is lost. I think that for a long time, certainly speaking personally, I've been trying to squeeze ministry to young people into an old way of thinking, a way of maintenance, that the structures we have in the church, the way we do things, somehow we have to try to get our young people and push them and squeeze them into this old way of thinking and old way of doing. The Synod has encouraged me to think a little bit more ambitiously about engaging in new ways with young people, where they are at, to hear them, to listen to them, to walk with them, and then to encourage them to become the missionary disciples to their peers. There are enough young people. We've heard some wonderful young people here, and I'm thinking throughout the Synod, do I know these people at home? Do they exist? And the answer is yes, they do. Do I encourage them enough? No, I do not. Do I enable them to exercise their role as young people within the church? Not enough. And therefore, I must go back home seeking ways of reimagining parishes, reimagining dioceses, reimagining even our own Episcopal Conference. How can I bring more of these talented, articulate, faith-filled young people into the daily life and decision-making roles within the church at home?
Ho una breve esperienza. Abbiamo avuto una missione cittadina a Vienna già alcuni anni fa. Abbiamo fatto molto per la missione, ma ciò che mi ha aiutato di più in questa missione erano giovani che mi hanno invitato ad andare con loro nei bar e i locali di dove mai vado per condividere la loro esperienza di missione, il loro coraggio, la loro disponibilità ad andare alle periferie, direbbe Papa Francesco. Questo mi ha svegliato. Dunque spero di essere un po' meno pavoroso nella missionarietà del mio ministero.
Perhaps what strikes me more is an intervention of a young person who said, how many of you know us by name? That was a big challenge. I know I have very many young people, but I'm ready to try and know as many as I can by name, by their situations. Perhaps it's not just a question of memory, but to identify myself, empathize with each one. Anyone who I meet, I want to give him time. I must make time. That's something we've been doing, but I am pushed. And part of that, one of the other young person who spoke about his own experience, I think he's from India, and how he was pushed almost to suicide, but how he recovered because of accompaniment and understanding and empathy, and how now he's thinking of becoming a priest. So vocation, which is also part of this synod, comes through, like Jesus calls us by name, because he knows us by name. So vocation is not just an activity organized. It is when we really reach out to each person by name and are able to meet their issues personally as far as possible, obviously with the help of my collaborators, but how I'd wish I would leave just maybe 10% of the challenge given. Thank you.
Tom Reese from Religion News Service. A question for Cardinal Schoenborn. Could you explain to us what's the difference between collegiality and synodality? After the Second Vatican Council, there was a lot of talk about collegiality. In the strict sense, the Pope and the College of Bishops and their responsibility for the church. But it was also used in a much more general sense of a style of governance in dioceses and even in parishes. Now Pope Francis is using the word synodality. What's the difference? Is it just one has a Latin root and the other has a Greek root? Could you, you're our best theologian, so that's why I'm asking you.
That's a question that had to come from a Jesuit, okay? So.
Okay.
Father Reese.
Okay. Yes, I'll try to give a Dominican answer to the Jesuit's question. The answer is very simple. Collegiality concerns the bishops because Vatican II had this beautiful image or notion. Jesus has established the apostles as a college, as a group, collegium. And the successors of the apostles are not individually successors, but when I was ordained a bishop, I was ordained certainly for a diocese, at the title of a diocese. It was a titular diocese, but I was ordained to be member of the college. Synodality is a much wider notion. It concerns, so to say, the functioning of the church. I had the privilege to be the keynote speaker at the 50 years jubilee 3 years ago of the institution of the synod by Pope John Paul, by Saint Paul the Sixth, I began to speak about synodality, speaking about the experience of Jerusalem, Acts chapter 15. What happened there? That's exactly what is the meaning of synodality, is to walk together, to be together on the way of faith, and that's concerning everybody. It doesn't take away the difference of functions and ministries and roles within the synodal way of the church, but it's the way how the church functions. And I recommend just to read what St. Paul VI said when he instituted the Synod of Bishops. Of course, it was a Synod of Bishops, but it was an expression of the synodality of the church. Synodality is, as you said, be lived in a parish, in a diocese, and in the universal church.
Cindy Wooden, Catholic News Service. Especially for you, Archbishop Martin, there has been differing comments on the amount of time the Synod Assembly and in the draft document has spent on the question of clerical sexual abuse, mm-hmm. its impact on the church's credibility, and especially its impact on young people. I was wondering, how do you feel about the amount of time and attention that has been given to that issue? And how do you react to those who would say that it's an issue of great importance in a very few countries?
Okay. Well, first of all, when we arrived here to begin the synod in early October, I think this issue was probably the most serious issue on our minds, because of everything that had been happening in the months prior to the synod, because of the continuing revelations and new stories that were emerging in different parts of the world. And I think that I and many of the Synod Fathers felt that it was very important for us to own this issue and to name this issue very prominently, particularly at the beginning of the Synod. In fact, almost as, listen, we need to talk about this before we can really talk about anything to do with young people. And so certainly in the very early days of the Synod, this was mentioned by a number of the Synod Fathers in plenary. But also, when we met for our first discussion group, we devoted a considerable amount of time to this issue. You may see that even in the first reports of the Circuli Minore, where the Synod Fathers wanted to express this, to really lance this wound that was there in the side of the church, in the side of the Synod, and to name it as an issue which disturbs young people and which disturbs the church, which disturbs parents, which disturbs mothers in particular. I can say that from the experience in Ireland. Having named it and expressed a wish that the issue would be mentioned prominently in the whatever final document comes from the Synod, we then moved on. It re-emerged from time to time in some of the interventions at plenary level, and it re-emerged in the group discussions, but no longer as the main focus of our discussions, but almost as if, listen, this is an issue that is with us and must remain with us. I have often said that. Some people have said to me as a bishop, do you think the church will ever be able to put this issue behind it? And I say, no, and nor should we. Because people who have been traumatized by abuse never are able to put it behind them. They carry it with them throughout their lives. And therefore, so should we. So I think that really that is the spirit in which we have addressed this issue. With regard to the importance of all the countries of the world owning this issue, I think, yes, I have said this and I would say it again, that sometimes I feel that there are still areas in of life in the church where this issue has not yet come to the fore or been come to the light. And I think that there are perhaps still some areas in which this issue is denied and not given its proper place. I think that Pope Francis is calling of the convention in February to discuss the issue at a global level will help to ensure that more countries take this issue seriously. And I hope and pray that they do.
Jean-Marie Guénot, Le Figaro. Abbiamo ben capito l'esperienza di comunione che voi avete parlato, è molto formale, questo non si dice niente sul contenuto. Dunque la mia domanda è di che rimanerà di questo sinodo per la Chiesa? Quale sarà la novità? Dove il cambiamento sarà una nuova visione del sacerdozio? Sarà una nuova visione della sessualità? Omosessuali, sessualità di preti, sessualità di giovani, sarà forse una nuova visione della donna nella Chiesa? E la mia domanda ultima, si può immaginare un prossimo sinodo sul tema della donna?
Well, I can just make a quick response to that. I think what we take away from this synod is a new vision and energy as regards to the young people. It will be a rejuvenated church guided by the Holy Spirit as the Holy Spirit wants to guide it. We don't know what the document will be, but we hope it will give some guidelines, some lines upon which we can start walking. But certainly the synod has at its heart youth, the young people, vocation, discernment of vocation, and they are taking responsibility. So one very obvious and we are certain will be is a re-energizing of the youth apostle, but re-energizing of the young people, and hopefully a rejuvenation of the church. that will come as the Holy Spirit guides us along the way.
Quisiera añadir algo. Yo creo que una de las cosas más importantes, creo que lo había dicho al inicio, es que es una iglesia con los jóvenes, no por los jóvenes. Y ese es el primer paso, porque lo digo de mi experiencia personal, mi responsabilidad, yo la tuve cuando se sentí parte de la iglesia. No era un objeto, como muchas veces, desgraciadamente, y tenemos que decirlo, a veces ha pasado, los jóvenes como simples espectadores. Los jóvenes hoy son protagonistas. Y el sínodo quiere dar esta nueva imagen de jóvenes protagonistas, jóvenes que quieren ver un futuro que hoy para los jóvenes es difícil ver. Y ustedes trabajan en este campo y saben que es difícil un joven hoy pensar en el trabajo, pensar en un futuro, a veces por la migración, es difícil. Entonces la iglesia quiere dar una respuesta. Ciertamente la iglesia también pide, y pienso que es parte de la sinodalidad, que seamos todos, no que sea la iglesia sola. La iglesia con todos, con ustedes que están aquí, con nosotros que estamos participando en el sínodo, pero también con aquellos que en un momento determinado no han sido comprendidos. Lo digo de manera personal. Yo pienso que es una de las cosas que da el sínodo, y nosotros los jóvenes hoy nos sentimos más responsables delante de una de los problemas que hay, que existen en el mundo, que son tantos, son muchos problemas. Los problemas no son uno ni dos, los problemas son muchos. Yo pienso, por ejemplo, en América Latina con la migración grande que hay. ¿Quién pregunta? ¿Quién dice? ¿Quién da una respuesta a eso? Yo pienso en los jóvenes que no tienen trabajo o que son explotados por los pocos trabajos que hay. Yo los miro a ustedes y yo veo también jóvenes. Yo veo jóvenes aquí. Pensamos en el futuro de nuestros propios jóvenes. Pensamos en el futuro porque estamos viviendo un mundo presentista y la iglesia quiere mirar el futuro. Entonces, esa es una novedad. No pienso solo para la iglesia, sino para nosotros.
I think I would also like to add that this particular synod was not a synod which was taking up a particular doctrinal issue and saying, look, will we change this or will we change that? It was a synod about youth, vocation and discernment. The Synod did, of course, touch on many issues. It touched on those issues from the point of view of young people. In fact, in many ways, the Synod identified the kinds of pressures that young people are under. That first week, where we heard some of the terrible, traumatic situations in which young people of the world are living, the reality of poverty, the reality of human trafficking, the reality of young people being completely lost in many Western countries, a huge increase in mental illness, depression among young people who are yearning for some kind of stable reference points, some sort of moorings, things they can hold on to that are not just constantly changing. In fact, if anything we felt, one of the messages I certainly will take home is the importance of the church fearlessly presenting often a countercultural message to the world in which young people drown and are being suffocated. That the church is able to say, listen, we have a reason for living, a reason for hoping, a reason for continuing to hold on to the precious gift of life that you have been given. And I would like to think that if the church doesn't just chase after fashions and changing this and changing that in the hope that that will somehow attract more young people, it won't. The church has to present clearly and fearlessly a message which sometimes goes against the grain of what young people are experiencing and hearing elsewhere.
Susie Pinto, EWTN News Nightly. My question is for Archbishop Eamon Martin. You mentioned that, come over here, sorry, that the church hasn't done a good job of communicating its message, and the synod at this point has you wondering where do church leaders go from here, and how do you implement what you've learned in the synod in your with your faithful in your dioceses. So Irish citizens voted overwhelmingly to overturn the abortion ban in Ireland. I think the number was something like 66%. Now that a few months have passed, what is the church in Ireland going, have you had a chance to do a postmortem and figure out how the church is going to communicate its message and specifically on that issue and regain its, regain traction?
Mm-hmm. Okay. First of all, one of the things that that you will notice if you study carefully the exit polls, for example, on that referendum in Ireland, was that the overall vote was indeed 66%, two-thirds majority in favor of removing the protection of life for both the young child and the unborn child and the mother. But among young people, it was much greater. There were only about 17% of young people who voted in favor of the referendum, who voted in favor of life. And that is troubling. And it is troubling to ask ourselves the question as to why are young people who are passionate about life and who are passionate about justice, why are they able to be so easily convinced that if you remove the fundamental right to life itself, that somehow you're being a more compassionate person? Among those 17% of young people who did vote to protect human life were many young people who were courageous to go out in that countercultural manner that I mentioned and try to persuade their peers. I met two young people in the week after the referendum who were in tears. They said, we knocked on doors for 6 weeks and we talked about the importance of life. And look at this. Our message has been rejected. It was worthless. And I said to them, no, it was not. Every person you spoke to about upholding the precious gift of life, every conversation that you had was important. And in fact, we now need missionaries for life more than ever before. As you know, many countries of the world have adopted abortion regimes. Even in those situations, we need courageous people who will speak up for the value of all human life. And that certainly would be one of my take-homes from the Synod, not to give up on the fact that there are many young people who are still prepared to stand up for the church's teaching in this critical area.
Xavier Lenormand de l'Agenzia Francese Imedia. Ho due domande. La prima è per Paolo Ruffini. Nel documento che ci avete mandato ieri sera hai detto che stasera c'è la votazione per i membri del Consiglio ordinario. Vorrei sapere se avremo una comunicazione oggi dopo di questa votazione. E l'altra domanda è per i padri sinodali. In una intervista il Cardinale Gracias, che è membro anche della commissione di redazione del progetto di documento finale, ha detto che in questa bozza le parole sinodalità e discernimento sono molto più presenti che nei interventi e discussioni in aula. Vorrei sapere se anche voi avete avuto questa impressione. Grazie.
Dunque, per la mia parte, sulla votazione che sarà oggi pomeriggio, non credo, perché la composizione poi del sinodo andrà, dei componenti della segreteria andrà completata e andrà completata con un membro che sarà del dicastero competente per il prossimo sinodo e poi con i membri della, della di nomina pontificia. Quindi sarà poi reso noto quando ci saranno queste altre cose, la composizione completa del, del collegio della, della persona segretaria. L'altra domanda non era per me, giusto?
No. No. L'altra domanda sulla sinodalità e discernimento. Come?
Ma forse posso dire che la parola discernimento è fondamentale già nell'instrumentum laboris che abbiamo, abbiamo avuto a, a parlarne tanto perché è la spina dorsale del, del, di tutto il sinodo. Il discernimento è proprio ciò che Papa Francesco ci insegna ad ogni momento. Non è perché è gesuita, ciò che è anche bene essere gesuita, sì, ma perché, perché è l'urgenza. Non abbiamo ricette per tutto, ma dobbiamo discernere qual è la volontà di Dio in, in questa situazione, qual è la chiamata della realtà. Un vecchio gesuita da noi diceva: Dio ci abbraccia con la realtà. Incontriamo Dio nella realtà e oggi il Vangelo di oggi è proprio questo. Voi sapete discernere il temporale che viene, ma non discernete le, i segni del tempo. Ecco, questo è il discernimento. E come si fa il discernimento? È proprio il cammino sinodale che è il cammino del discernimento. Certo, l'autorità del Papa alla fine, come l'ha detto già nel Sinodo di 14, ha detto, e alla fine parlerà il Papa. E ha parlato. E ha parlato chiaro. Ma prima viene l'ascolto. L'ascolto di altri. Forse avete letto John Henry Newman, Blessed John Henry Newman, on the consultation of faithful in, in matters of faith. È proprio questo la sinodalità. Dunque, la parola sinodalità non, non era tanto presente nell'instrumentum laboris, ma è ciò che abbiamo fatto, ascoltare la realtà, poi discernere ciò che Dio ci dice attraverso la realtà, alla luce della sua parola, alla luce dello Spirito Santo, e poi passare all'azione. È proprio questo cammino che si chiama sinodalità. E dunque penso che non è solo utile, ma necessario di discernere quale è stato il cammino sinodale di questo sinodo.
Grazie. Ultima domanda, Eva.
Sì, Eva Fernández de la cadena COPE. Mi pregunta es para Monseñor Quique Figaredo. De su experiencia estos días en el sínodo, ¿considera que ha llegado el momento de que Asia tenga mayor poder de decisión en la Iglesia o todavía queda mucho camino por hacer? Gracias.
Gracias. Yo creo que las dos cosas. Asia ha estado muy presente en el sínodo, bueno, y seguirá estándolo. Y la participación yo creo que ha sido muy buena, en, tanto en, por las personas que están como por las comunicaciones que ha habido. Y yo creo que esto va, va a seguir creciendo. Que la, la Iglesia de Asia es, hay, tengo que decirlo, es muy joven, hay menos instituciones, es pequeña, es ágil y tiene muchas cosas que ofrecer porque vivimos de una manera minoritaria, somos más fermento y la realidad nos hace que tengamos que estar cooperando y colaborando con otras religiones, con otras culturas, con otras personas que trabajan por el bien del mundo, como puede ser, por ejemplo, por la justicia o por la ecología, que no son cristianas. Y claro, Asia te aporta a la Iglesia algo que igual otros lugares que en donde el catolicismo es como más mayoritario o históricamente ha sido muy fuerte, pues aporta cosas nuevas, ¿no? Entonces, yo creo que seguirá creciendo la presencia de Asia en el mundo, por decirlo así, en la Iglesia global, ¿no? Pero yo creo que estamos en proceso. Yo creo que aquí un asunto que nos dice este sínodo es que estamos en un proceso con cambios, y un cambio va a ser que Asia va a estar más presente en la Iglesia.
Gracias, Padre Quique. Adesso per qualche intervista breve. Padre Quique rimane qui in sala, anche l'Archbishop Mujeria e Archbishop Martin viene in salutino. Grazie, ci vediamo domani, ma non all'1:30, nel pomeriggio tardi.